Without the plankton, there wouldn't be any other life in the sea. Their abundance determines the abundance of all other creatures. You can't see it unless you peer at it down a microscope. And if you peer at it down a microscope, suddenly a whole new world opens up before you. Wildlife in the sea expects everything else in the sea to be edible. They don't expect plastic to be floating in the ocean. The food chain begins with the plankton. If microplastics enter the plankton, then the microfibers can move from the plankton to the fish. And of course, other fish will eat those fish. At the moment, we don't know what those consequences might be, but all we know is that the pollution in the sea can move up the food chain. You can almost say it's a tragedy now that you collect a plankton sample and you can never look at it now without finding microplastics. Since clothing containing this material became common around about the 1950s, it's estimated that there are probably 1.5 million trillion, or about 3 million tons of microfibers now in the ocean.
In one simple wash of polyester clothing or nylon clothing, you go from something that's considered a macroplastic to a microplastic in a blink of an eye.
When you dry your clothes, the little fibers which we can't see, they are on nanoscale. It's thrown out in the air. If they are in the air and if it rains, you can call it plastic rain if you want.
Plastic polymers are designed to persist. Investigations suggest that for some polymers, it can be up to thousands of years. Every other breath that we take, that's coming from the ocean. So it's very important that we understand what we do on land is affecting the ocean environment, because that ultimately leads back to us and our health. We have a research initiative called the Microfiber Partnership, where we are addressing microfiber shedding from textiles. What surprised us in that first line of research was that materials within the same categories can have huge variation.
The different weaving processes, the different fibers used, the different treatments, the different dyes, the different ways in which it's washed or brushed, the different ways in which it's handled, and the different ways in which the water that's used is then put back into the environment. Most research has focused on the consumer end. What our research has shown is that first wash is the place where the most microfibers are commonly released. So if that is true, then what is the implication further down before that first consumer wash?
They can get entangled in the intestinal environment of the plankton or organism. There's a concern that may cause them to be retained for a much longer time. With that extended length of residence in the gut, of course, there's more opportunity for chemicals to leach out. It's a huge knowledge gap right now, understanding of the chemical impact of those fibers.
We had the opportunity to survey an island that it's a 6-day boat ride from Hawaii. We went after a bird called a red-footed booby, which is a subsurface hunter, so it's gonna be one of those iconic birds that flies and then dives below and grabs a fish. With birds that feed on the surface, there's a higher probability that they might take in a plastic just incidentally. But with birds that are diving below, you know, there's less of a chance of that happening. And still, we went through their fecal samples and we found abundant plastic fibers. And again, these are birds that are days away from humans. At this point, it would be a surprise if we didn't find, if it was a clean sample that didn't have any type of plastic, you know, contamination. That would be a big surprise to us, sadly. They're able to penetrate pretty much every ecosystem because they're able to enter the air as well as the water. And that has all sorts of health implications for us if we're breathing this stuff.
If they're in your body, it can cause inflammation. And inflammation is often a precursor to cancer. So right now, I am looking at different methods to extract microplastics from human tissues. And we are trying to develop a method so that we are efficiently able to recover any plastics that might be in those tissues.
You know, we've identified a ton of different delivery pathways for microplastics to humans. That's not a mystery anymore. We are actively working to try to prove and show and demonstrate all of the negative effects that plastic has. But if we just keep seeing it build up in the environment, by the time we really establish the population effects, the human health effects, it's going to be beyond control, beyond repair.
One of the questions often asked is, can we do anything about this?
We are dealing with a large system and we need deep systemic change.
We're never going to be able to go cold turkey. You can't just stop. It's everywhere because it's cheap, it lasts a long time, it's durable.
Whilst we are still doing our best to understand, to close the knowledge gaps with microfiber impacts on the environment, what we know is that we need to take action now.
Technological advances might help us reduce the flow of microfibers into the ocean.
If we can create something that replaces plastic without having those negative sides to it, then it's a really good thing.
We know that there is a vast amount of material entering our ocean and that we need to do something. There are methods of weaving, of textile construction that have lower shedding. So let's put those forwards. Let's explore what that looks like and let's better understand how we can knowingly reduce the impact that we're having now.